You're not being protected. You're just a sitting duck on the World Wide Web. Everything they told you is a lie. Let's talk about it. My name's Art, this is Cantankerous Tech, and today we're going to talk about why most VPNs are completely useless and what to do about it. I was originally going to name this video something along the lines of secrets that VPN providers don't want you to know. VPN services hate him. But in reality, this was more about just making sure you know what they're really offering you, because they're not going to be transparent. They have to use a little bit of that fear angle to get you to buy. And even top-rated tech sites will have comparisons of the best VPN services. In reality, most VPN services don't do very much to actually protect your privacy. They don't really do much for anonymity. All they really do is assign you a new IP address, and that's about it. Like, some of them have other services they can do where they'll generate dynamic IP addresses so you can get onto your Netflix when you're out of the country, for example. Reality, there's usually a lot better ways of doing that, often for free. It doesn't really make that much sense. And so a lot of these companies, they try to sell you services that they think you'll need, and they scare you into needing. But at the end of the day, they're not actually really helping you with the things they say they are. Let's talk about some of the many ways in which you can be tracked on the internet is IP address tracking. And to the defense of VPN service providers, they do a good job of obscuring your actual IP address. However, that might be a moot point for a lot of people. If you live in a part of the world that has a dynamic IP address, your IP address could be changing all the time. For example, my home internet is powered by T-Mobile and uses different towers in the area. And at different times, it hops back and forth between different towers. And when I'm using my mobile phone, there's thousands of towers in my area that I could be using. And that basically shares me with the other people who use that same network. And a lot of people's root IP address is just that shared. They use other identifiers. So one of the problems you have there with VPN IP addresses is you can discover who runs this IP address. I've stumbled upon a list of a bunch of random known NordVPN IP addresses. There's a lot here, but we can grab one at random and you'll see the company that Nord is partnered with right there, Global AXS. Now, all those IP addresses on that list, which I'll put in the link below, almost all of them go to Global AXS. That's where they buy their IP addresses from. So basically, it's the same as being on a shared IP address in your area. Sharing an IP address through your VPN is really no different than sharing an IP address through your internet service provider. But that's part one. Part two is fingerprinting. And let's talk about fingerprinting. And I'm going to use Chrome browser to kind of describe how this works. So this is Chrome browser in guest mode. There are no plugins on this thing. And as you can see, I've done the fingerprint test here. And we refresh it again. It's going to do it again. And it's going to figure out my unique fingerprint. There you go. You are unique. Now, if I launch, because I have the free account of Proton VPN, if I go ahead and connect that, as you can see, I'm connected now. I refresh. No change. The cookies and the fingerprinting on my browser give me away. There's a lot of data on here that you may not expect in a fingerprinter. Obviously, it can tell the browser I'm using, obviously. It can tell what version of Chrome it is. It can tell that I'm using Linux. If you come down here, there's even more crazy stuff, like the plugins I have installed, my screen resolution. Let that sink in. The screen resolution of my monitor. Here's my favorite. There's my video card. It knows what video card I have. Side note, I want to show you something. Boom. These are my patrons. Magnificent, right? And you can too. A link down below. Now, another way they track you online is cookies. the delicious little nuggets that are used to identify you. Now, the biggest problem with cookies is they are everywhere. They use them for everything from keeping track of your login status to like Facebook and Google and all that kind of stuff, but also they're used for ads. When you run an ad blocker, you kind of cut them off at the knees for the most part. When they use the cookies to track you for ads, that's really the main reason companies like Facebook and Google are even going to be tracking you in the first place. So getting a solid ad blocker like Ublock Origin, which is my recommendation, that just completely negates that issue. Now, if you're really paranoid, you can't really beat the security that comes from a browser like the Tor browser. The Tor browser, not only does it tunnel through the Onion network, the Tor network, but it will limit your cookies to the session you're logged into. The moment you close the browser or simply reset the session, it's all gone, often with a brand new IP address and all that kind of stuff. Now, I don't want to say the technology behind VPNs is bad, because it's not. It's actually really amazing. And protocols like OpenVPN and WireGrid, platforms like OpenVPN and WireGuard are actually really amazing if they're implemented in a way that makes sense. And to kind of wrap this mamma jamma up, Tor browser is probably the most secured way to use the internet, and it's free and open source. So if you're really worried about privacy, that's a great option. And it's often a lot better of an option than a VPN. And because it's free, there's no credit card tracking to you, which your VPN. Now, a lot of VPNs say they don't log, but let's be real. You think these large companies that have spent millions of dollars are going to throw it all away for one bad actor? No. Again, this comes back to threat modeling. Who is your threat? Who are you protecting yourself from? And that's a really hard thing that everyone has to kind of figure out on their own. I went through my own journey of understanding what my threat models were. I went down the rabbit hole of de-Googling all the devices and having everything open source from the firmware up to the best of my ability. And I learned a lot. But in reality, that's not going to work for everyone's threat model. In reality, it didn't even work for my threat model. So this was a long and winding road that brought us to the end here. What are you doing to protect yourself? And if there's anything I've missed, let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. And if you like this video, go ahead and give it a like. And if you haven't already subscribed, I will have a video coming out about a good VPN service that actually does stuff like a VPN, like some kind of network. But you'll only be able to see that if you subscribe. So I do want to apologize about the drastic changes in the background. I'm trying to make sure the camera has me in white balance, but it's a cloudy day, so things keep coming in and out. So, sorry about that.